Welcome to the Zelda Informer podcast. I am your host, Alfred Tabax, joined today by my co-host, Nathaniel Rumpfeljantz.
Hey.
We've got a lot to talk about today, as Nintendo Everything has posted three separate interviews with Aonuma from three different websites. They all contain different information about Breath of the Wild and some other things that go on in Nintendo. And so I wanted to hit those. They posted the summaries. They said that Nintendo Everything said that they will be posting the full translation of each one of these interviews at a later time, but they wanted to summarize all the information on it so that you could read what they said before the full thing came out.
Glad to see you keep up at ZeldaInformer.com. We've actually been posting that stuff all day.
We do have some of the stuff, but not all of it.
So that's because people like us have not been... Well, people like me... I had another job to go to, but all of the stuff is actually in the queue and broken down.
Well, I had a job interview today, so that's enough.
That's good. That's good. Yeah, my best friend just got hired today. First job out of college. So
plus this is also a little bit easier to just read down, because I'm going to read down each of these interview each of the summaries, and then we'll talk about them. So the first one is from the French site Le Monde. I probably mispronounced that, but they're French. So they put up the interview with EJ Aonuma about Breath of the Wild. And so here are some of the things that they talked about, and then we'll just talk about this one and then move on to the next one. So it says the team for Breath of the Wild consisted over 300 staffers, about 300 staffers, 4 years of development. They listened to Japanese fans in particular for feedback due to it being its native language, but looks to consider feedback worldwide. Aonuma points out that American players aren't big on upgrading abilities to progress, such as in games like Monster Hunter. Nintendo was criticized for the lack of freedom in the past, with different areas being connected by small paths. The player now has freedom similar to the original Zelda. Aonuma believes Breath of the Wild will be a key entry in the series, obviously. Experience points and leveling up was never considered. Rather, Nintendo decided to implement the weapon system. To gain high-level equipment, players need to be smart about how they approach the game. Link's speed is adapted to the pace of the game, and there are different things that are hidden in the world, and you could run at full speed, but you may miss a lot by doing so. With Skyrim, Aonuma likes how you enter a new town and it feels different from the ones you've entered previously. So from Whiterun to Morthal to different towns, have different looks, different characters, different quests in them. He wanted to create something like this, but in a different way. This is why you can climb anywhere. On shrines, he said having them all be long and complex means that players wouldn't complete the game. So Nintendo made shrines to be rewards rather than actual trials. Shrines are very different from those of previous Zelda games, though some are much larger and have a boss at the end similar to traditional dungeons. Nintendo has also done away with the dungeons that have a particular theme. For example, even if you come across a shrine located in a forest, it won't necessarily carry that theme of the forest through the shrine. Architecture was not based on specific life locations, but rather inspired by different pieces of architecture from around the world. However, for Zelda Ocarina of Time, this was an exception in creating the Temple of Time. Aonuma also wanted to have more islands in Wind Waker, but hardware limitations prevented that. Criticism from the game didn't actually inspire Breath of the Wild, even including the art style. Art style was chosen so that objects could be more easily seen in the world, and we've covered some of this and given a more detailed response on this one. With the actual excerpt from the interview. Artists have also been brought up on Japanese animation, and Aonuma stopped leaving messages to his son in games since his son told him that he had grown up and he didn't need them anymore. Finally, Aonuma also wrote all of the lines for the old man that you find at the start of the game. So a lot of that was just a bunch of random... Some of it was just random trivia, but some of it had important background into what went into making the game and how they made some of the decisions that they went into. So I just talked a lot. Nate, you give your opinions on some of that.
First, to clarify something, and this is, we haven't corrected it on our set yet either, and that's because these breakdowns are based upon the same thing. Like I mentioned before, you know, we posted a bunch of stuff to the site. Well, we posted the Google Translate versions, because I don't know if we have anyone on staff that natively speaks French, but we weren't going to wait to get this news out. And it appears, after you went through that list, that Nintendo Everything based their breakdown on the same thing. Because in that breakdown, you mentioned, I guess might be the most interesting point, the stuff about dungeons. Mm-hmm. And if you kind of read the breakdown, you kind of read the Google Translate version, it kind of suggests that there isn't like themed big dungeons. Well, I shouldn't say big dungeons, but there isn't themed dungeons, and that, the dungeons are kind of sort of the shrines. Mm-hmm. That's actually not the case. And it's weird because, like, he actually said in an English interview, like, last week that there are dungeons that are not shrines.
Well, it says in the interview that they posted, it says the shrines are different than, like, previous Zelda dungeons. But they're also, the shrines themselves aren't the ones that are themed. Like, specifically, like, forest and fire and stuff. The dungeons, however, probably will be. We haven't gotten any indication.
Yeah, but if you read what everything says and what we say on our site, it reads as the shrines are dungeons and they're not themed. So the shrines, I never expected them to be themed anyways. They are a unifying theme across all the shrines. At least it's been that way in every single shrine we've seen, and I see no reason that they're not going to continue that unified theme of all the shrines. Which, you know, knowing what we know about how many shrines there are, will that get boring? I have no idea. I'm not bored of it yet, but I also haven't been through all of them. So maybe by the end, maybe I'll think that they could have did something more original. I have no idea. I kind of likened it to, like, even in Skyrim, like, when you go to caves, like, all the caves are the same. Mm-hmm. They're just repeated over and over again, just in different locations. So it's kind of what I think they're with the shrines, except the shrines are not all the same. They're all do something different. Some are very, very, very short. One of the first shrines we saw off the plateau, I couldn't believe it was even a shrine. You just hopped on your paraglider one time and you're done.
Is that tutorial?
I don't even know how it's a tutorial, because, like, to get to that trial, you already had to have used your paraglider. So it's just a really weird... Oh. Really weird thing, and, like, you know, I hope that most of the shrines aren't like that. I have a feeling, because of how many there are, that is what most of them are going to be. Mm-hmm. However,
I'd say a good portion, maybe not most of them.
Yeah. But he kind of so to kind of clarify what he was saying to this, because I had this thread open on YoGaf, because they originally also reported exactly what Google Translate says. Which is, it started this big drama because, there's no dungeons. It's the shrines, and they're not themed. So, like, you saw what those shrines looked like at the beginning. That's what your dungeons are going to look like, which could kill some of the variety. Even though, you know, so to clarify, all he's talking about specifically here is just about shrines. He is not talking about dungeons at all. And he's comparing shrines to dungeons because in previous Zelda games, that's the only comparison that exists. Because what the shrines are doing was previously only really done in dungeons. So that's kind of trying to clarify. So, like, the shrines are, it doesn't matter if they're in a forest or in a desert. It doesn't matter. They all have that unified theme. You know, so it's not like before where, like, you go to a dungeon specifically and that dungeon is the forest dungeon. That might still be the case if there is a separate dungeon that's not a shrine. But that is not how the shrine itself works. And obviously there's a lot of speculation that the dungeons themselves are just the four giant robots in the corners. But we don't know that for sure, to really say that. And it says that basically the shrines themselves were kind of built to use the physics engine. Everything was kind of like all the puzzles in it, they try to make more physics-based. So... Just to clarify, none of this has to do anything to do with actual dungeons, and there's still going to be actual dungeons in the game that are not shrines, that are probably most definitely themed around whatever they're themed around. So, now that that drama is because seriously, that's all people have been talking about, like, all day with me. I'm like, what do you mean there's no dungeons? I'm like, I don't speak French, I don't know. I thought just last week he said there are dungeons, and now they say, confusing stuff. There's a lot in this game. I think even Ichi Aonuma gets confused at times because there's just a lot going on. And he even, it's funny because if you watch that Treehouse stream from a couple weeks ago, he said live on air that there's little things in this game that he doesn't even know about. So he doesn't even know everything. That's just how big this game is. So honestly, that first interview, my biggest takeaway is I'm really glad that there are going to be shrines of bosses at the end. That's cool. That makes me feel a lot better about say that the original rumor back in the day is true and there's only four really big dungeons, like more traditional style dungeons. I am a lot more okay with that when you have shrines that are like mini dungeons that have bosses at the end. And I'm assuming the ones that have bosses at the end have the better awards, you know, whether they're another rune ability or yeah. whether it's like a really strong item that you can use for a little while before it breaks. You know, just
maybe like armor yeah. or something.
I mean, anything, you know, it feels like if there's going to be a boss at the end, it has to be a pretty important reason compared to the shrines we've seen so far. You know, and in a later, I think he says this in another interview we haven't got to yet, or maybe he said it last week. I don't know. There's so much Breath of the Wild stuff swimming around in my head. I'm mixing things up, but the shrines are basically included to give the player a sense of progression. Basically, you are being rewarded with the shrines through your exploration. So, like, every area will have, you know, X amount of shrines or whatever it is. And you're only going to find them by exploring. They didn't want you to necessarily explore and end up not finding anything. So shrines were kind of like an answer to that. Mm-hmm. And I think they were an answer to it. I know for sure he says this in another interview where he kind of goes off to... They were tracking where players were, like, playtesting. And they were tracking where players go. And they're playtesting, like, okay, everyone's going off in different directions, but at some point in the game, they all started going the same direction. And why is that? What's going on? Why are there parts of this world no one's exploring? So they had to, like, redo the topography to kind of get it that way, maybe redo some story elements to make people, you know, not necessarily feel like at this X point in the game, everyone go this way. They don't want that. They want everyone's experience to be different. And they want people to freely explore and have a reason to. And I think shrines are kind of their big reason. And he kind of calls shrines rewards. And that's what they are. They are your reward for exploring. And from what we've seen in some of the trailers, like, there's a shrine that came out of the ground. So, like, some of the shrines probably even have to be activated. You won't even know they're there. Mm-hmm.
Maybe by clearing, it could be clearing a cap.
You know, maybe there's a switch that you hit somewhere. yeah, I don't know. I mean, that first interview, there's a lot of stuff. I just don't think there's a lot of super important things.
It's more just background into how they made the game and what inspired.
You know, a lot of it's really interesting, but it doesn't really present anything new besides the fact that shrines are going to be. Some of the shrines are going to be really, really badass, is what it sounds like. Everything else is just kind of cool, like 300 staff, 4 years. I mean, yeah, I figured it had, you know, 300. It was supposed to be, like, the biggest staff they've ever assembled, so... the 4 years of development's always interesting because it will have been almost 5.5 years since Skyward Sword, and supposedly he claims that he started, like, the think pot for the game, like, right after that game finished, even before it released. So, you know, and I kind of put I put this as a comment on the site. I think what that means is that there was only 4 years where they took that team of 300 and actually physically made a game. And there was probably, like, 6 months in there where it was just Eiji Aonuma and the director sitting there trying to conceptualize what this game is. And then the rest of the time is polish and localization. So I think that's what that extra year and a half in there is. That, and obviously they moved it to the Switch, which probably added like another 5 months.
I'm also interested by like some of the earlier points when they talk about how they got some of the ideas for the game, talking about how he said that North American players aren't big on upgrading abilities to progress, similar to Monster Hunter. And I was trying to think about that, and that is more of a... a JRPG thing. Because I was thinking... here's the thing. I don't know if he's talking specifically about, like, leveling up.
Yeah, because, like, what he said in that feedback was... like that remark comes from, you know, how they accept feedback. And he notes in there, this wasn't expanded upon or everything, but if you actually read, I don't know, again, the Google Translate version, he kind of explains that... What he receives for feedback is what Nintendo America tells him reviewers in North America are saying about the game.
Yeah. The thing is, though, like basing,
Monster Hunter is really weird because of the lack of appeal of Monster Hunter, I don't think has anything to do with the progression system at all. Like, that progression system is prominent in Western RPGs. So,
well, you see leveling up skill trees and Skyrim.
Like, Borderlands, you know, having to hunt things down and collect materials. Like, that's, like, the lack of appeal of Monster Hunter is basically the gameplay. Not the elements that are built around that gameplay. It's the gameplay itself. It's, to at least Western audiences, in my experience, I love Monster Hunter, but it is a clunkier kind of experience with your battling. Until very recently, there was no way to target anything. And pretty much every game since Ocarina of Time has a targeting system. And there was no way to do that in Monster Hunter, and that really turned off Western gamers. And just kind of the way they present the game. Like, there's always a home base, and then you just kind of go out and hunt, and then you come back to your home base. And that's kind of how Monster Hunter has always been. And that isn't the kind of progression people want to see in the West. Because it doesn't feel like you're actually progressing. Yeah, you're getting better armor, but there is no feel of that progression. That's why that's a really weird comment.
Well, I think that it's also weird that would be his litmus test, specifically Monster Hunter, which is a Japanese game.
I don't know why it wouldn't be like Xenoblade or something.
Well, I mean, even then, further past that, you'd think that he'd be thinking, okay, well, obviously there's something about the leveling up in, say, Borderlands or Skyrim or Fallout that people like, with upgrading skill trees and
But it sounds like all his feedback comes from Nintendo America, and they're not looking at reviews of games they don't
make. Yeah, that's what I was thinking, is that they're specifically targeting games that they've put out and published on their consoles. And again, it's neither here nor there at this point. Like,
well, look at what he said about Skyrim. Breath
of the Wild.
He was quoted back in 2013 that nothing in Breath of the Wild has been inspired by Skyrim. Well, it turns out that that's not entirely true. The core mechanics of the game aren't necessarily inspired by Skyrim. Like, the reason there's cooking, as we'll find out here in a later interview, has nothing to do with Skyrim having cooking. That wasn't actually inspired. Like that was one thing I see a lot of people argue, like, oh, cooking, like, that's what all these other games have. Like, no, none of that has anything to do, like, the item durability and the cooking wasn't based on other games. And you'll see that in a later interview, how he explains why they went that direction and how it was just ideas that their staff came up with for a certain direction they wanted to go. But, like, his comments on Skyrim, it's really interesting because this shows how little I think Nintendo pays attention to anything outside of their ecosystem.
Well, it's interesting because in the second interview that I'm about to get to, they talk about the other games. Like, it specifically says that Aonuma talked about how they studied other games, like Western games, and took inspiration from that. So it's interesting that, like you said earlier, that he said that, well, it's not inspired by any of these games, but obviously it is. Nintendo had to understand that.
Like, look at his comment specifically on Skyrim. He says, "What really got me more into Skyrim is when you walk and enter a new city, there's a real shock. Ah, there's a city here. And she's so different from all the others. This is the first time I felt this in a video game." Like, that's been in video games for, like, decades.
Yeah.
So, like, if this is the first time he's experienced that sense of when you go somewhere, it's completely new. I guess I don't get it. Like, how little do they not look at what the rest of the world is? Even in Japan, Final Fantasy has that.
Well, more than that, like, think about Nintendo. They like to stay within their own infrastructure for the games that they make and their view on them, and their view on games. And so, I imagine that, like, maybe Reggie, who I don't think he has that much to do with the making of games. But he's talked about other games that he likes, and I assume that they play them, but I think that for the longest time, Nintendo's wanted to differentiate themselves from that, area of gaming, and so they've stayed away from games like Skyrim and games like, Witcher and games like all those games that are heavily Western influenced, specifically because they want to be different and they want to be Nintendo, And then they started to realize after Skyward Sword that that's not working anymore. Like, sure. They can't get behind the curve and just stay back even and that. Watch it.
Like, when he says that Skyrim remark, I kept thinking The Legend of Zelda, the very first game in the whole series, worked that way.
With the different towns?
Well, not the different towns, but, like...
Different areas.
They did it with the different areas and the different, like, dungeons and all.
I think it might... I think he means more along the lines of, like, the... Like, different... Like, the life of the town, if that makes sense. Like, you see in Skyrim that you have... Like, you walk into a town, and every character has a name, and every character has a story to them. And it's a living, breathing town. And I think that may be what he's taking away from it, is that it's not just a different infrastructure, a different look, but every character is different.
And I'm back.
Where'd you go?
Hold on. All my audio's all messed up now. Apparently I hit the power button on my microphone underneath the table. I don't know how that happened. Yeah, I'm still recording.
Okay.
I just sat there and talked for like 8 minutes with silence.
Okay, I was wondering where you went. I was like, hello.
Anyways, yeah, I'll kind of recap what I was saying before since it never got recorded.
Okay.
That I think, as we find out in a later interview, that Miyamoto and Eiji Aonuma did not... agree on what the essence of Zelda is. And apparently they've been debating this all the time. It's like the number one conversation they have when they make a new Zelda game. And Breath of the Wild is the game that's most like the very first game in the series. And apparently this was like the first time like ever that Miyamoto and Eiji Aonuma have agreed simultaneously on what the essence of Zelda is in Breath of the Wild. That's why I think it's interesting that it kind of took a different game like Skyrim to make him understand what Miyamoto was trying to do with Zelda in the first place. So it's weird. That's why, like, because I wrote an editorial about how clearly, look at all this stuff that Zelda's done before. How can this be inspired by Skyrim? And here he is basically saying, well, yeah, I was inspired by Skyrim because I didn't understand what Zelda was before. and that's not a surprise because he's openly admitted he has never played and beaten like the first two games in the Zelda series. He's played them, but he can't beat them. They're too difficult for him. He doesn't get it. He's never understood them. And maybe that's why his games have been so different from what Miyamoto was doing. I guess he was inspired by Skyrim to go back to what Zelda used to actually be, and he finally understands why. Like, aha. Freedom of exploration with all the stuff to discover. That's amazing. Why haven't we been doing that?
And it's interesting that it's weird that they used that example for Monster Hunter for that earlier. Like, this is the reason why we don't have this, but they've been looking at other games, and he's talked about Skyrim and Witcher 3 and stuff like that, and said that...
The Last Guardian he talks about too.
Ooh. Yeah. All these games he used for inspiration, they have these leveling systems. I guarantee you people are not upset about that, or not a lot of them are. We reposted my, I wrote an editorial a while back about what the next Zelda game needs to be and why it should be an RPG. Like a traditional JRPG with the leveling up system and stuff. But nobody liked that. So obviously there's not a big enough fan base for that for a Zelda game. It's obviously if Nintendo wanted to do that, they'd have to do it with something else like Xenoblade, which it works well for. The system that they have is in good place. But on to the second interview then. So this one's from Jake's video. Butchered that as well, probably. This one is about like the Wii U gamepad as well as working with the Switch. So here's a summary of it. He kept quiet on timeline placement, but still didn't tell us where in the timeline it falls. He says, "For clues, though, remember the voice of the woman who says that the world has suffered many battles against Ganon, which could lend to the theory that this is pulling all the timelines together, or I don't know, I'm not going to get into that right now. He said the team wanted to create something it never had before, and because of this, Nintendo decided to make a bigger Zelda game and then tried to find new ways to make the world interesting. They decided to start working with the assets from Wind Waker as from the ground up to reach the anime style they were aiming at. He said while he played, studied, and took inspirations from games like Skyrim, GTA, The Witcher 3, and Last Guardian, like you said. However, Aonuma stresses that the Zelda touch being a part of Zelda, all of the Zelda games, is more important. And we talked about how him and Miyamoto finally agreed on what that was. Said his teams are more serious than him, and when he brings such ideas, they would tell him that they need to do something more original, or even better, or more Zelda-ish. From a technical standpoint, it didn't take too long to create the game. Development choices such as making an open world is what took so long with ambitious plans. And obviously, this was not a question in anyone's mind. Since it was originally planned for the Wii U, the team thought it'd be funny if Link had a tablet similar to the gamepad. So it's supposed to be a gamepad. It was. They modified some elements of gameplay when the Switch arrived, i.e. could no longer use dual screens with the gamepad, and the tablet aspect of the game was reduced due to Switch. Aonuma said he's not talking about DLC, says that if that were to happen, it would be after the game releases, so there's nothing to share now. He said, working with the Switch went well, and porting Zelda over went faster than expected. He and his dev teams are far from mastering the Switch's hardware, but the Sheikah Slate was supposed to symbolize the gamepad, but was abandoned when the Switch version came into the picture. The idea was that the tablet would talk to you. When playing on the TV, the gamepad would display information and the tablet would speak. Ultimately, though, they felt that the gamepad was out of place. So he talks a lot about the gamepad there and how they had all these plans for it. And obviously, like, when this game was in development for the Wii U primarily, and at the beginning, it was probably a vastly different game than what we got now. In terms of some of the core gameplay mechanics like that, obviously when they revealed the Sheikah Slate, everybody thought, oh, that looks like a Wii U gamepad. It's because it is. That's what it was supposed to be. But as the Switch came along, they scrapped that, and along with probably many other ideas, such as using it for a map, using it for hints, like they said, because they wanted, I guess, the Switch to be the definitive version. After all, why would you buy a version of the game missing several core features on a newer console? Like, they want Breath of the Wild to sell systems, so they're not going to include all these extra features on the Wii U that they're not going to have on the Switch. To give it a one-up. That'd be bad marketing. So some other things that I thought were interesting were that he would come in with all these ideas that weren't very Zelda-ish, and his team would have to humble him with them. And that they've been trying to... Obviously, the open world part is the most... it's the central focus of this game, so they wanted to make it as big and ambitious as possible. And so that's what they've been focusing on the most. I think that's pretty much the stuff that I took away from this. Like I said, everyone figured that the Sheikah Slate was supposed to be the gamepad.
He actually said that a couple weeks ago.
But obviously that idea was
that the slate is a gamepad, but then, you know, well, I mean, he said that and then he immediately said, but we also think it kind of looks like the Switch, so it still works.
Yeah, but I mean, like, when we first saw it, that's what it was.
Plus,
like,
every single functionality we saw of it at the Game Awards 2014, like the ability to, because in this game, you can go on like your Sheikah Slate in-game and like zoom in and mark places. Well, he did that back at the 2014 Game Awards, and he did it through the gamepad. So clearly that used to be a gamepad functionality. And that was the Sheikah Slate functionality. So clearly, I think anything you can do with the Sheikah Slate in-game originally was all on the gamepad. Literally, they were going to basically say their gamepad is the Sheikah Slate, is the idea. I know there's some people that are interested in all that gamepad functionality. He said in an interview like a week ago, that he thinks that the game controls better now than it did when it was on the gamepad. Which, of course, marketing PR, he's never going to say the game's worse. So do you really believe that he actually thinks it's better? Or is he just, you're not going to say something negative about a game that hasn't even come out yet? Maybe he'll admit, 10 years from now that, oh, he wishes they would have kept those features. But Like, I heard someone say that, oh, you know, they wish they could have seen the voice talking to the thing. I'm like, really? We had that on the Wiimote. It wasn't that great. It really wasn't, yeah. like, that's not groundbreaking. That's not, like, oh my gosh, gamepad. Like, they did it with Wiimotes. It really was kind of annoying. The speakers usually aren't that great. I mean, obviously the speakers on the Switch are going to be better. But the speakers on the Wii U gamepad itself aren't that great. To me, it felt like even though it's marketing PR speak, I kind of could understand why maybe the controls they ended up settling on and the functionality, at least to me, is better. Because my biggest negative, I guess, with the gamepad is that none of the uses of it in any games on Wii U, outside of Zombie U, which is like the lone exception, increased my immersion in the game. It was always a distraction, sometimes a convenient distraction, like inventory systems.
Well, like if it,
like it's well, it's yeah, a convenient it a distraction, system, like it's still a distraction. I got to take my eyes off the TV, refocus. Yeah. Plus, the gamepad itself, like screen, was not that good. So, like, I'm looking at this kind of okay looking, yucky, washed out, blurry screen, and I got to readjust my eyes to the HD big screen in front of me. Kind of sucked, but. You got used to it. That's just the way games were on Wii U. So I would have been fine with that in this game. But the inventory system they ended up landing on, like the quick swapping of weapons, that's even faster than me using the touchscreen. Because I got to take my eyes off this TV, look down, locate the item I want and tap it. Or I can just hold the button, quick swap, and I'm done. And there's nothing saying they couldn't have had both systems in the game. And maybe they did. I doubt it. I think they had all the management on the touchscreen, but... Anyways, it's one of those things that I guess I wasn't really that interested in the gamepad features, like holding the gamepad up to telescope through and mark points on the map. Like, that's cool. It's not really better than the alternative. It's trying to prove the value of the gamepad. Without really doing anything with it that isn't just as good with a controller. Even if you want to talk gyro controls, that's fine. There's gyro sensors in like the Switch Pro controller and the Joy-Cons. So you could still have the motion if you want the motion. The gamepad isn't really... the screen on the gamepad, to me, just the way that they were using it that we're aware of and that they hint at isn't anything I feel like I really needed. Even as the map and inventory is convenient, like they use in Twilight Princess HD and the Wind Waker HD... it's not something that is such this big annoyance. Like, the whole idea of it is you don't have to leave the game to manage your inventory, right? You don't have to go to a pause menu. Well, if I'm taking my eyes off the TV to do it anyways, what's the difference of having a menu on the TV? Either way, I'm not looking at the game. You know? And that was always, like, my argument for why I thought the inventory management systems were better on the gamepad, but that's because of how clunky they were in The Wind Waker and Twilight Princess. It wasn't because... You know, the gamepad just offered a convenient way to do it better. That doesn't mean they couldn't have did it better in those games. And what they're doing in Breath of the Wild to me is loads better. I'm not sad to miss the Wii U gamepad features. A lot of people were hoping they could play Breath of the Wild on Wii U with the Pro Controller anyways.
I mean, I think the only thing that I would have liked would have been a map.
Yeah, the map. The map's nice. Again, I don't know why that... I guess personally that doesn't matter to me as long as there's a one-button access to the map on the... And it seems like I think one of the D-pad directional arrows has a one-button access to it.
Probably.
From what I've seen, I think it's like arrow. I can't remember. So as long as I have a one-button access, I don't... Who cares, I guess, to me?
Yep.
If I have to take my eyes off the screen to do something that I could easily do on the screen anyways, then I don't know why menus are a problem, I guess. But that's just me. There's plenty of people that think, like, oh my god, the game's going to be worse. And that's, I guess, fine.
I mean, the only thing for me, for the only reason that I liked it better on the Wii U was still the Wii U had a lot of processing problems. So, for example, when I was playing Darksiders 2 on the Wii U, switching from the game to the menu in the game took longer than it did for me to look down onto the Wii U gamepad, switch over to the map, and find where I was.
Some of that's the double processing smaller things like that.
Yeah, no, I'm aware. It's just that stuff like that was a little bit more handy. Obviously, the Switch is more powerful than the Wii U by, like, miles. So I don't think we're necessarily going to have like a 5-second delay between opening. Plus, this is a Wii U game ported.
And they already and they openly admit we are not even close to understanding all the power and capabilities. So it's like, okay, well, they're not even using everything the system can do. Which, hey, people who are mad about the 900p, it's a Wii U game at 900p. The Switch is weak. They didn't even go through to see what the Switch can do. They didn't push it.
So,
like, he just openly admitted we didn't push the hardware. So, don't use Breath of the Wild as a barometer for the max of what the system can do.
I think the barometer for what the system is going to be is going to be
Super Mario. I don't even think that's a barometer. Super Mario is a highly stylized game.
Yeah, but we'll see in terms of what that looks like. But there's one last interview.
One more interview?
Yeah, one more interview that we'll talk about. This one is also a summary on it. It talks a little bit more about the development of the game. Notice all of these are with, I think, French companies. So, come on, Aonuma, come to the States.
We just asked really stupid questions.
I know, but...
Did you read some of the English interviews? There was, like, the same amount of English interviews, and they were just really stupid questions that we already have answers to. Come on, United States companies. Like, heck, pull your own fan bases and see what questions they want you to ask, because you're not good at coming up with questions. Oh, my gosh.
So, the interview said... or Aonuma said in the interview that you can get lost in the original Zelda game and for the Nintendo Entertainment System, and Breath of the Wild is somewhat like that. It says, you can get lost by not knowing where to go or visiting places out of curiosity. That curiosity is what sparked the idea of exploring or climbing in Breath of the Wild. Though Aonuma doesn't want to make things too complex, but he believes that the different systems in the game, like equipment, will be easier to understand when playing. The physics engine took so much time since changing just one aspect can affect everything else, since the engine handles different aspects of the game world. Companies outside of Nintendo also helped out with playtesting. Nintendo staffers working on different projects also tried out the game, and a PC tool was created for playtesting which tracks the paths players take, like Nate mentioned earlier. Aonuma likes the idea of a multiplayer mode / feature where players communicate with each other when visiting a certain place. I imagine something like Dark Souls, where you leave messages. I don't know that that's going
to
be in the
game. Yeah, he laughed in the interview and said, I'll take that idea back to the team. Game's done, so it's not in there, but...
It said, Monolith Soft actually helped with Skyward Sword with the design, graphics, and artistic elements, but Nintendo and Monolith have different approaches to games, obviously. On Breath of the Wild, the team was helped by level designers on topographic amenities from Monolith Soft. Twilight Princess was more difficult to manage than Breath of the Wild for two platforms, since he had less experience at the time. For this game, he's also able to better prepare to ensure that the experience would be the same on the Switch and the Wii U. Now, when Aonuma starts thinking about new ideas, he thinks they could work in Zelda and always comes back to the series, and this prevents him from working on other titles other than Zelda. He implemented cooking as a logical choice, since you pick up ingredients in the world, and the team thought it'd be interesting to mix for effects. Exploring by climbing everywhere, living in harmony with the world around us, and protecting something or someone to accomplish a mission make up the essence of Breath of the Wild. Mm-hmm. And that is the end of that. So, like you said, the cooking aspect and the weapon aspect wasn't made because they liked the idea in other games. It just was, it was natural
to them. Yeah, basically they were going to have elements in the world that you could pick up and eat. Like, it was just going to be part of the game. Like apples, as an example. They mentioned in 2014, well, these apples on this tree. Oh, yeah, you can pick them and eat them. And it sounds like, you know, like, that's not new in Zelda. There's been items like that in Zelda. So it sounded like, okay, well, we're going to have a whole bunch of these in that world. Why don't we make it so players can mix them? And thus, cooking was born.
Yeah, and it sounds like, again, they're talking about Monolith Soft, and they're talking about how they've helped with other games and how this one was, he was more seasoned when coming to Breath of the Wild. So, not that this was an easy game to make by any means, but he felt like he was more prepared for this, and that the Switch and the Wii U gameplay and both versions felt the same, so that you didn't feel cheated when you're playing one. Like most people say that the GameCube version of Twilight Princess is the definitive edition of the game, And I mean, you could say that's Twilight Princess HD now. but he wanted to make sure that they're the same. It's essentially the same game. There's definitely going to be some graphical updates, and it's going to run better on the Switch just because it's a more powerful beast.
Basically, the Switch will be the definitive version. But it's not going to be like a noticeable difference. It was on a mirrored world. Yeah. It's not completely different controls.
Unless you're playing them on two TVs at the same time, you probably won't know.
It's not one in a 4:3 aspect and one in a 16:9 aspect. One with pointer, shooty controls, one without.
So that's pretty much all that one talks about. I don't really have much to say about that other than what we talked about, because we addressed a bunch of the stuff outside of the interview.
Yeah, mostly important stuff I brought up, because this is the interview I enjoyed the most, because we got the most interesting stuff out of it, in my opinion. What's interesting is that... and this was brought up in another interview and clarified further in this one, is that it feels like what made this game take so long. Because we've heard multiple excuses about why Breath of the Wild was delayed. You know, EJ almost screwed up feedback. He openly admitted to that. He didn't tell them what was good about something. He only told them what was bad, and so they changed too much stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So they had to kind of retcon those changes. Well, we kind of get more detail on that in this, and it's not included in the summary, but if you read the interview... he goes on to talk about even more details on the physics engine, and that they had to, what made this game take so long compared to other Zelda games, which is interesting that he says compared to other games, because Skyward Sword took almost just as long to make.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know why he thinks this is an abnormal length of time, but, it's that because of those changes, like, you mentioned, you mentioned the physics change. Like, you make a change to one thing and it affects the rest of the game. He said a comment, like, last week in an English interview that he would go to an area, like, EJ Noma went to an area and there were supposed to be some items there, but they were gone. And he had to go to the development team and be like, hey, what happened? And they're like, oh, well, the wind blew it away. And all those items were at the bottom of a mountain. And it turns out, we now know why that happened. Someone wanted to do something in a shrine that involved wind pushing clay pots. But the default wind system in the game, in the physics engine, wouldn't do that. So he changed one of the values to make that puzzle work in the thing. Well, late in other areas of the game, because changing that value affects the whole physics engine, that's what created all those pots being blown to the bottom of the mountain. And it turned out that it was a lot of stuff like this, because this physics engine really sounds like this is why the game took so long to get it right. Because he said he had to take all the teams, because how this game is developed, I'm not going to talk about how all games are developed, but how this game is developed is they kind of have like little groups of people doing different things. Like, you're a dungeon designer, you're an enemy designer, you're a wildlife designer, you are like a topography designer. So they have all these different groups of people that work on the same engine, and everything kind of comes together. That's probably how it's always been with Zelda. Well, in this case, because they had this overarching physics engine, everyone's trying to make changes to it, not considering how it affects everything else, how everything's connected. So throughout the development process, he had to take all those teams, sit them down in a room, and have them play through the game together and experience all the other things they're not working on to see what they're doing and how it's affecting everything, and get the teams communicating more. And this is why the game took so long, and why he says openly... once he realized that the teams needed to communicate and be in the same room and play the game together, so they can make the physics engine work perfectly, as we assume it does, that's when he realized, man, I need to go to management and ask them for more time.
Mm-hmm.
And boom, bang, boom, that's the delay. Like, it sounds like there was really only one delay, because that second delay from 2016, that literally sounds like that's because they decided to put it on Switch. It's not development reasons. So the actual development reason that this game didn't land in 2015 is because, hey, the teams needed to communicate better about this physics engine. So they had to change how they develop things. And I think that's a really interesting approach, because I'm not a game developer. I have worked on little games, little indie games, but that's a totally different environment than AAA publishing, the AAA game making. So I am interested to know, like, is this how games are made? Like, everyone just groups off and then they make stuff and it just gets slapped together.
I feel like that's a Nintendo thing.
I feel like it is too. And like he explained in the past, like how they made games, like it was just little paths connecting each environment and each section of the game. And I feel like each one of those sections was made by a little team, and that's just how they connected them.
Yeah, like how like they were like, okay, well you have the forest temple.
You work on the Lost Woods and the forest temple. That's your team.
Yeah, then you go to the water temple, and then
you make Kakariko Village, and so the people, you guys make La La Ranch, and we'll just connect them with paths, and it'll just work. And I'm the developer, or I'm the director. I'll worry about the story that connects it all. I don't know. I hope that's not how all AAA gaming is done. It can't be, not with an open world game, at least. And I think that was what happened with it was. They realized that probably a year or so, or maybe 2 years into development, they're like, crap. We can't make this game like we've been making games. It doesn't work. We need to rethink how we do it. And that starts at the top. The director who came over from Capcom, I forgot his name. We finally have the director of Breath of the Wild officially confirmed now who it is. He's the guy who directed the Capcom games, and he also directed Skyward Sword. And now I can't remember his name. Mm-hmm. And I feel bad that I don't remember his name now, because he's like a pretty big name for Zelda now.
I'll look it up while you're talking.
But, those decisions have to come from Eiji Aonuma and the director. So part of me is kind of glad, just like I'm glad that Eiji Aonuma is looking towards Western games. Which is funny that like The Last Guardian gets thrown in there. The Last Guardian is actually not a Western game, but it plays like a Western game. But it's interesting that it took...
Okay.
Yeah.
Hidemaru Fujibayashi.
Okay, Fujibayashi. Okay. So, I don't know. It's just really interesting to me. Because what these interviews did collectively is something that I wish, the English interviews would do more of. And that is, they didn't focus on asking things they clearly weren't going to get answers to. Like, tell me what the timeline is. Or... Because like every English interview asked him, where does this go in the timeline? He's obviously not going to tell you. If he wanted you to know, he would have already said it. So like after a game is released, you can ask him. Then he'll give you an answer. But the thing is, he has given answers in the past, but that was always part of... He always planned to give an answer. Like this is 100 years after this. Well, he doesn't want people to know yet. But they would always ask him questions, that weren't very interesting. They were always about trying to get spoilers. And these questions in France at this event in Paris, they're development focused stuff he can talk about. Mm-hmm. So I think what I find most interesting out of all of this, beyond all the insights we've now learned in how this game was made, which I think is amazing, is just the stark contrast in how French media and United States media deal with the same person on the same game. And I wonder if that represents, the differences between, not just the media, but, the differences between the audiences for the games. Where, in the United States, we care about, hey, why the heck isn't this thing Twilight Princess HD Wii U Tecmo graphics? That's all we care about. Instead of asking, why behind the art decision. Like, the art decision is because they wanted to make this easier, and because... This is a company in Japan that has Japanese animators. They don't have Western animators. So,
Well, think about it, kind of in the aspect of how we have different cultures, mm-hmm. and we have different values. It's almost like we have different video game mm-hmm. values. Like, there's different things that we look for in a video game in American culture overall. Like, maybe not us, mm-hmm. you and me, because we favor more Japanese games, i.e. Nintendo, i.e. Zelda. But... when the overall audience of America looks at games, I could name my roommates, a few of them, they look at games for graphics. If it doesn't look like the best game that's come out in the world, then it's probably not going to be worth their time. It has to be pretty simple. Challenging isn't exactly the best thing. So heavy puzzle games, really complex games, and so some of that might be negative, but then there's also things like story. We're really we really like story in games, and we really like to hear about the story in games. And that's something we never really got from.
Hence, everything Naughty Dog makes
is a heavy story. Yeah. so that there's different. We look for different things, and have different values in general as people. But we also have different values in what we look for in a game or a movie, which is why, you know, Japanese video games are so different from American video games, and Japanese film and French film, it's all very, very different than what we have here, just because of our values, just because of what we like in entertainment. And I guess, like you said, that's reflective of our media, too, because our media asks certain questions based on their viewership, but also based on what they know the audience wants to hear and what they want to hear as interviewers, and how they want to approach certain questions, because they want to ask certain questions based on what we want to know, what we value.
Yep.
I'm probably repeating myself. No, it's okay. There, but that's what I'm imagining is the difference there, because like you said, they're asking questions that are more about development and how they came to these decisions, as opposed to, well, why doesn't this game run in 1080p or something like that? Like, that's not their main focus with these questions. And it's just interesting. Like, that's a human study that I'd love to go into. But we've got some pretty good fan questions.
Here and, we go.
I want to get to some of these, and then I kind of want to, there's a topic I want to talk about. It's not really like, I haven't planned a game or anything afterwards. It's just a topic that I want to talk about. And I want to see where we can go with that. So, first fan question then is from Cedric Patrick Jackman on Facebook.
Personal experience talking to this guy.
He says, I know how this will sound coming from me, but I'm not the only one who feels this way. Could you please, please, please talk about the changes, I assume, in Breath of the Wild? I understand that you guys enjoy them. But could you try and discuss them from a neutral point of view and at least pretend you understand the opinion of us who don't like the changes? So, I actually know what he's talking about, which is surprising, because I remember reading the day after that Breath of the Wild was announced, a bunch of news articles talking about how this is the most Western-looking Zelda game, how a lot of people are upset that it's so Western-focused, and it's so different than other Zelda games in terms of gameplay, story, how it, like the open-world aspect of it, the towns, everything about the game has been expanded and been made different. And I know a lot of people aren't happy with that because they want their Western games to be Western games and their Japanese games to be Japanese games. And they don't want them to mix and intermingle, especially a game as big as Legend of Zelda. And so I can kind of understand that because we don't like change as human beings, especially when it's something we really, really like or something we're really, really passionate about. We don't want to see it get altered in any way. It's like if you're watching your favorite show, let's make up a show, let's call it Arrow, and let's pretend that the first season's really, really good, and then the second season's pretty good, but then they're like, you know what, let's make this completely different and let's change the dynamic of the show, and all of a sudden it's like you don't like it anymore because it's bad. But some people do like it, and that's the thing, is that there's different tastes for different people, and you can't please everyone. But I think at this point, Nintendo saw where the trend was going with The Legend of Zelda and with games in general. And if they wanted to stay relevant, and they wanted The Legend of Zelda to stay relevant, then they would have to go on this quest for change. And I can understand, like, it's hard for us to understand from a neutral point of view why you guys don't like these changes, because for us we're like, oh, these are great changes, like these are what we've wanted in Zelda games for such a long time, like voice acting, a story driven game, open world, non-linear dungeons, all that stuff, like this is stuff we've wanted for a very long time. But there are some people that look at Ocarina of Time and are like, every game needs to play like this, like a linear story with like specific items for specific dungeons, specifically themed dungeons, and you just need to go through the story like a movie. And it's hard, again, it's hard for us to understand that, because like I said, Nate and I like these changes for the most part. I assume Nate does. I don't want to speak for him, but I want to see where your guys are coming from, and I understand your side. I just can't feel the same way you do. And maybe Nate's different. Maybe I'm wrong and Nate hates the way the game looks.
Okay.
But
the thing is, I'm trying to be neutral about this because this Cedric Patrick Jackman, first off, if you're listening to the podcast, thanks for tuning in. I've actually been conversing with him back and forth on Facebook like all day, the day that we recorded this, because he's been very vocal about all these changes, not liking them. And the changes that he's talking about, like he's not even necessarily against the open world, but against a lot of the other fine-tuning changes, like breakable equipment. That's just one example. What else did he say? Things like the fact that when you cut grass, you don't get rupees. A lot of stuff that has basically been a staple in every single Zelda game for 30 years, that it's just gone. And how jarring that is, and how much he dislikes these changes. You know, the green tunic, that's a very popular one that people have been very vocal about. And
yeah,
part of me is different because I got to play it. So I come from the perspective of I didn't know what to expect until I played it. While you guys were watching that live at E3, Nintendo Treehouse, getting all this insight, I didn't get to watch any of that. I was on the show floor trying to get my hands on the game. So I went into the game not really knowing anything but what the first two trailers for the game showed, which wasn't a whole lot. Revealed the name and showed me an open world. It was basically all it told me. So I went into the game not knowing how the item, how breakable weapons worked and how all the stuff would fit together. And EJ Aonuma kind of said this in an interview that we talked about today, that the breakable weapon aspect has to do with world progression and player progression. And it's something you will understand as you play the game. So I think, like, on the surface, I see why people do not want breakable weapons. And that they think it cheapens the experience and it doesn't feel like Zelda. And all I can say is, as a Zelda veteran who's been playing this series since I was 5, I'm 30, I'm as old as the series is, that I was with you until I experienced it myself. And I get it. This game would not work without that breakable weapon system. It just could, it would not be what it is. And it's something that can't be conveyed to you, because it's something you have to experience. You can't just watch some gameplay clips because you're just going to get frustrated. Oh, he was using that sword and it broke. Dang it. Well, that's stupid. What a waste of time that I have to go gather more items. It doesn't make sense to you until you have that game in your hand. And then you realize, oh, if I had a non-breakable weapon, think about how easy this game would be all the time. And the thing is like, that's not necessarily a bad thing. Zelda has been easy. Let's not kid ourselves. Zelda is a relatively easy action adventure series. It's kind of been easy probably since maybe Majora's Mask. I'd argue even earlier than that. So Ocarina of Time was very easy. Man, I thought A Link to the Past was pretty easy. Honestly, I don't think anything's really been that hard since Zelda 2. And the first two Zelda games were very difficult games, and then the series got dramatically easier after that. And has just kind of progressively gotten easier, even up until Skyward Sword, where, yeah, even if you don't want to do the controls the right way, you can waggle your way through the game without knowing what you're doing. It's still beat it. Believe it or not, it might be frustrating, but you can beat Ghirahim in those one-on-one sword fights by just waggling your remote. It doesn't mean you won't fail a bunch, but you'll eventually beat them. And I've witnessed people doing it, so it's like, oh man, well, that's not how you're supposed to play, but whatever, it works. And it works because Skyward Sword was such a new idea with the motion controls, the combat really wasn't that hard. You know, it's all puzzle-based, basically. So it really wasn't that difficult. Everything's telegraphed, and it's easy to figure out. But it was so easy that you didn't even have to do it right and you could still get it. And that's kind of the way the series has gone. And the way that the progression model works in this game, just it's something you need to play to make sense. Like, as an example, in the past, grass has always been something that you get rupees, you get bombs, you get extra arrows, you get a magic meter filled. That's just what it's been. But the reasoning that it worked in previous games is because everything was in patches. It was a patch of bushes. It was a patch of grass. Most grass in Zelda games up to this point have been a flat texture that you could not interact with. We've never had a world that had realistic grass. And now we have a world, an open world, that grass is literal individual blades of grass. And it's everywhere. And if you would get rupees and bombs, or, well, bombs they put through an item use now, but, you know, say arrows for your bow and arrow, even just like the basic of basic sets of arrows, so you can get that from grass. The game would be too easy. Like, way, way too easy. Money wouldn't matter anymore. There's grass everywhere. Just burn it all down and collect thousands of rupees in 2 seconds.
Inflation.
Yeah. Well, and that's the thing. Like, inflation, like, rupees are harder to come by because of this. They are. They drop off enemies. We've seen proof of that. So we know that that's one way to gather rupees. I'm sure there's side quests and mini games and stuff. But it's one of those things where they didn't change this because they wanted to change a fundamental of Zelda, like the grass thing. They changed it because in the way the world is built with all this grass, it negatively impacts the gameplay to keep it in there. Yes, and it's something that until you play, until you go hands-on, it doesn't make sense. And obviously at E3, it was weird because like there was like rupees were not dropping off enemies at E3. There was, you could find rupees in the demo, but they were like ones that were hidden. They weren't like, you know, or whatever. And like even in the past, like in Ocarina of Time, you could run through some of the tall grass and there would just be rupees in the grass. And there isn't to say that that doesn't exist in the world. Maybe there are patches of long grass where there are rupees hidden in it. We don't know for sure. We have not seen every blade of grass in this game to know that. But the, you know, the general gist of it is everything that they have done in this world, whether it's the item, the breakable items, or the change to the grass, or the fact that there's not this default green tunic he wears all the time, and that these tunics have different effects, like different effects on heat and different effects on durability, or like how hard of a hit you can take, like with stats or whatever. All of it is built around the core gameplay, the core progression in the world. And it's a progression that we haven't really had in a long time in Zelda. And it's a progression that makes sense because we've hit this point now where technology has advanced to a point where you are not releasing a Zelda game that all the grass is flat textures. You just can't do that. Yeah, you can't do Skyward Sword again. It can't be flat textures.
Either step it up or
like that doesn't work. That's not appealing. Yeah.
As much as Nintendo doesn't want to compete, this is a competitive game market now, and so they have to in some way.
Yeah, like show like that the their game the horses
its own, you know, against.
I understand these you've always Western had RPGs. Epona.
Read some of the Japanese.
That's
ones.
Great, but yeah. Now you're in a world with a bunch of wildlife. A single horse existing in that world doesn't make sense. Like, it just doesn't make sense. And so if you're going to have other wild horses, then why not give the player the option to tame them? Like, you don't have that option in prior Zelda games because this wasn't possible in prior Zelda games. As Eiji Nomo put it, like, for the Wind Waker, he wanted more islands, but the technology wouldn't let him do it. We haven't had the technology to do stuff that we're doing in Breath of the Wild before. So now they do, and now they're doing it. And all I ask for anyone who's scared of these changes is wait and play the game for a good, I'd say a good 3 or 4 hours, and then come back and tell people what you think of these changes. Because I think, like the Wind Waker, which is probably the last time we really had a really radical change, change in art direction, change in you're not exploring like land, you're exploring a sea on a boat. You have a sister, which you've never really had a family besides an uncle before, and a grandma. Explored these new ideas, and it was instantly hated on, except for the people who played the game. And they ended up loving it and realizing this isn't a game for kids. Yep. But you only got that if you played it. It's a very serious game, actually. And Breath of the Wild similarly, where they made all these changes to the core, a lot of the core fundamentals, like the green tunic and the rupees in the grass and all this stuff. But you have to play it to get it. Otherwise, on the surface, it just looks like, yeah, okay, this is a Skyrim light. Or this is, you know, a game like Skyrim or a game like The Witcher. And the thing is like, it's not. But you have to play it to find out. And I, maybe that's why I've gotten so many arguments with people who think it's like Skyrim. It's because I played the hell out of Skyrim. Played the hell out of The Witcher 3 and The Witcher 2 and The Witcher 1. I played the heck out of Grand Theft Auto games. I played the heck out of all these games that are being compared to it. And this game feels nothing like those games. But on the surface, you're just like, oh, you can cook and you have inventory and your items break and there's crafting and there's this and that. And like, okay, you can make a checklist, but just play the game. It is not the same thing. So I want to be neutral, but I lost my ability to be neutral after I played the game. So.
Yeah. And I'm going to lose that, like, this weekend when I go play it at PAX. And that's, I agree. Like it's difficult to make a judgment on a game you haven't played before. I mean, if literally every review was coming out and saying, well, this game's crap, then you might have some form of like, like ability to say, okay, well, this game's probably going to be bad, but you know, everybody's,
and it's not just
praising this game.
Like, it's not just, sorry to interrupt.
If it's so widely,
it's not just that when you say everyone is praising the game, it's okay. Literally everyone across every culture, Japan people, French, Australia, UK, mm-hmm. Germany, United States, Canada, South America, like everywhere this game has been, there isn't any culture and any media outlet or fans going hands-on with it that have disliked this game. To me, that kind of goes into a larger point that in doing all these changes to the game, they actually made it even more appealing across cultural barriers, where in the past, Zelda has really struggled outside of the United States since Ocarina of Time. It's basically been U.S. people buy the hell out of this. Everyone else just kind of, and this game seems to be tearing down those walls. And now you have to consider why. You know, is it because they're going more mainstream? Well, Western RPGs aren't popular outside of the United States and parts of Europe. So if they're not popular here, but people in Japan are praising the heck out of this game in comparison to those games, then clearly something's different. And that's all I could tell you is play it. And I'm really glad to hear that Alfred's going to get a chance this weekend. I'm assuming at PAX. Yeah. So, sorry. Mm-hmm. Go on.
Yeah. It's okay. Another comment, another question from Chris Forbes. Always comments, always gives great questions. says, a lot of people weren't able to get the Zelda Master's Edition because of online pre-order selling out in minutes. Some of us got lucky and through a fluke pre-order through GameStop's brick-and-mortar stores. While originally Master's Edition was an online exclusive when purchasing through GameStop, their corporate offices have promised to fulfill these in-store pre-orders. That being said, do you believe Nintendo should create more stock in advance to give fans more opportunity to collect these treasures, or should they keep them extremely limited to increase the sentimental and retail value? And I've been debating this question with myself since I couldn't get one of these for myself. Because on one hand, you'd think that Nintendo, the Master's Edition was about $150, roughly. And you'd think Nintendo would want to be like, oh, well, everybody's going to want this, so let's mass produce the crap out of this thing so we can rake in the money. You know, $150 per game, per package would be great. But at the same time, it's kind of like, it's almost nothing alike, but it's kind of the same idea of getting trading cards. If every, like when you're buying Pokemon cards, put it this way, it's the fact that you can get one of those starter decks with like a Charizard EX card in it or whatever, cheapens that card. Because it doesn't make it worth as much. It's like, okay, well, everybody can buy this right off the bat. It's not rare. There's probably like millions of these in existence. But the fact that if you buy a regular booster pack and you get a super rare card, it's like, okay, this is worth something because, A, there's probably not a lot of them. And B, this was harder to get. And so intrinsically it has more value to it. And that's what I feel like any special edition, any collector's edition has, if it's a limited edition, is that it has this intrinsic value that, okay, this is rare. And it may be expensive and Nintendo probably could make lots of money mass producing this. But at the same time, it wouldn't be a special edition. It would just be a collector's edition. And they made it pretty clear that the Master's Edition is a special edition and then some. And again, I don't really like it, but I can understand it. Like, I really wanted to get the Master's Edition. I probably shouldn't have anyways because of money. Mm-hmm. But, like, I understand what they're doing. And I can understand, like you said, keep them extremely limited to increase the sentimentality and retail value. You don't want to inflate the market with limited editions because then they're not limited editions anymore. Then they're just regular old collector's editions, just like a bonus version of the game. Like having something like, I don't know if it's sold out. I haven't done any research into this, but I got the Dishonored 2 special edition, limited edition. So I've got like Corvo's mask. I've got Emily's ring, and it's really cool to have. And I don't know many people that have it. And so that adds kind of a value to it, knowing that this is a rare thing, knowing that this is a limited edition, a collector's edition that not few people have, but not a lot of people have. I mean, that's what makes it more appealing, too. Of course, there's always going to be scalpers. There's always going to be people buying, like, 30 of these copies everywhere they can find them and then just selling them for, like, 3,000 times the price on eBay. But that's just the world we live in. That's capitalism for you. And there's really nothing you can do about it.
What do you think? Anyone who wants the things in that Masters Special Edition, you can import. Because outside of like the United States, where capitalism is like this big deal, and scalpers kind of grab all the stuff and try to resell it for hundreds, if not thousands of dollars more than it's worth. It's not that hard to import. Like you say, like I had the Special Edition pre-ordered. It really wasn't that hard for me to get it. I think people that couldn't get the special edition, this is just in my opinion, because I happen to have enough local retail stores. If you have local retail stores that were selling it, I kind of view it as, if you don't have it pre-ordered and you wanted that special edition, it's kind of your fault. It wasn't that hard to get a hold of on Friday, the special edition, the Friday after.
When I got to GameStop, they still had copies of it. I just didn't get there early enough. If I really wanted it, if I really wanted a special edition, I could have shown up
before. Yeah, the thing is, like the lines aren't like 500 people long, you know. Like, this isn't like a launch day of something. Like, this was not hard to get because a lot of people did order online. But, like, the special edition specifically, there were stock set aside for in-store retail that you could have went to the morning on Friday and pre-ordered. And I know that there's always, you have a job. You couldn't get, like, my GameStop opened at 10, so I got it at 10. My job is Zelda Informer, so it's not hard for me to get off of work to go get in line. And for a lot of people, you can't do that. You have class. You know, you have things going on. And that does suck. It does suck. There's always circumstances like that. And this kind of gets back into, you know, in consideration of those people, in consideration of the people that didn't stay up till midnight or 1 a.m., whenever the pre-orders went live online, to get a pre-order in. You know, how is it fair to them? And it's not. And life isn't fair. And I feel like a total douchebag for saying that, because I do have the special edition ordered. And the thing is, I'm with people on that. I didn't want the special edition. I wanted the master edition. And I didn't have an opportunity to get it. Because it's basically online exclusive. Very few stores sold Master Edition in store, including GameStop. Most GameStops were not accepting Master Edition pre-orders.
Well, like you said, it was an online thing, and pretty much they sold out
immediately. GameStop canceling in store some of the special orders. They only canceled the online ones. They did not cancel any in store orders. So actually ordering in-store almost guaranteed you the product better than going online in that case with that retailer. This is just a thing I'm always torn on, because there's two collector's bundles basically for this thing, the Master's Edition and the Special Edition. And, you know, Reggie Fils-Aimé said the Master Edition is extremely limited. And it was really funny when he said it's extremely limited. So go out to stores and get your pre-order in. It was already sold out before that stream even happened. So before he even said it's extremely limited, you couldn't get it anymore. So like there was almost no point to even talk about getting it anymore. So that to me was a little strange. Like just from a marketing perspective, like why are you showing off this thing and telling people to go pre-order it when they can't? That was just really weird. Mm-hmm. Bad timing on Nintendo's part. But at that time when he said that, a lot of retail stores still did have the special edition available. So there's two minds of thought. So they could have had their collector's value and serve people who wanted to. See, they could have made the special edition basically make as many copies as you sell. And then the master's edition, make that the collector's one where it's the special edition, but you get that master's sword. And that's where the value is. And I'd like to know, I hope somebody asks Reggie someday, because this is a very specific thing. I mean, there's special editions and master editions like all over the world, but we obviously only know a lot of details behind the United States ones. It would be interesting for someone to actually ask Reggie in an interview. So like, why are there two versions? Why are they both limited? What about like something mm-hmm. like the Wind Waker? Like, can make it so people could all pre-order it. Like, they've done this, like the Wind Waker HD. Like, you can get a Wind Waker, you can get like a Ganondorf statue, or like with Majora's Mask, you could get a pin if you pre-ordered a totally different game for some reason. And I know that why that was done. That was to try to sell that new game. And then, which by the way, I think it's a really shady thing for you to do, Nintendo. Should package merchandise with a game that has nothing to do with that game. But then they also did like the I have it around here somewhere, the Skull Kid statue with Majora's Mask 3D, and that was extremely limited and hard to get a hold of.
That's right.
And the thing is, to get that individual statue is actually not that hard to get a hold of. There are retailers, like not resellers, normal retailers online that will sell you that statue individually for like $20. So like if you want that statue, you can still get it. It's not actually a limited thing, but it was limited at the time in the United States. And I'm really torn on all this because I almost feel like if they were going to limit these bundles, they should make the items available individually to purchase. Like, take that case the Switch case it comes with, right? The Sheikah Slate case or whatever. Mm-hmm. They could sell that individually.
Yeah. I might be wrong, and this might have been a rumor, but I thought I remembered reading at some point that these were going to become My Nintendo Rewards. Maybe,
and that still seems really...
and I remember seeing that somewhere that they were going to be then either again, sold separately or become My Nintendo Rewards. Would be nice. No, I'm aware. I'm not upset with that at all. I'm just saying, like, no, don't freak out if you can't get it, because... Typically with collector's editions, I mean, maybe not, like, this isn't a guarantee, so don't take my word for it, but sometimes they'll do second printings of them or second releases of them, like they did with the Amiibo. Like, they did a Wave 2 of Wave 2, which is so... that I hated the way they handled that. But, like you said, Nate, I'm torn on this because on one hand, I'm like, oh, man, I want one, but on the other hand, it's like, well,
yeah, it's kind of like
more value when it's rare.
If I had one, like if I had like I had the special edition, so I already feel like a special snowflake over here. So I'm speaking as someone who has a special edition order. But like if I had the Master's Edition, I gotta admit, internally it would feel cool knowing I have this thing that not many people have. And that's where the value comes from. It where it's like not so much increasing the sales value. Like obviously that's a thing that happens when you limit quantities of things. But that's not where the value is to me. The value is that I have something that I know most of the people that are watching me unbox it or watching it in the background on a video don't have. And it's they don't have because they can't get it. And not a don't have because they don't want to purchase it. Like in videos or podcasts, like in the background, I've had things like some of the Dark Horse first four figures that you can buy at GameStop or ThinkGeek. Anyone can go get those. Mm-hmm. No one's preventing you from having those. So they're awesome that I have them, but they're not as special as, say, something I have, like my Breath of the Wild shirts from E3, or my Breath of the Wild coin that also comes with the mm-hmm. special edition. But I have, like, a whole bunch of those coins. Like, not everyone has those. And that's really cool that I have something that not a lot of people have. And that's always something I kind of liked about being media, is way back in the day when, it might have been when Ocarina of Time 3D came out, We got our media copy of it. They sent with it a ceramic ocarina, like ocarina with it. And I'm like, this is cool because like only media people have this. Like no one can go out and buy this specific with, ceramic ocarina.
That wasn't a partnership. No, it wasn't even something that they made on their own.
Okay. So it was just really cool. So that's why I'm torn. Like, I personally like having things that I know a lot of people don't have. Thing is, I also, you know, should it be like that stuff I talked about from GameStop and ThinkGeek, where you can have it if you do, if you want it, you can just go buy it right in the store. It's not a big deal. I mean, it's a big deal for me to have it, but you know, it's not. You know, it's kind of like the difference between the Dark Horse first four figures that have basically unlimited stock, and you can just go buy them. And they'll just keep making them as long as people buy them. Compared to, say, an actual first four figure that's like hundreds and hundreds of dollars, that there's limited quantities, and they never run them again. So it's kind of like that, to me, those are not only higher quality, they're also a lot cooler to have in your collection versus something that anyone can have. So I'm torn between, as a collector, the fun part of collecting things isn't that everybody can get it. It's that I can get some stuff that other people can't. So you brought up the Pokemon card example. That's a perfect example. The first couple of generations of Pokemon cards, I had a lot of rare cards that most people didn't have. I had a first, what is it, one of those first edition foil Charizards in mint condition. Those were very rare at the time. It was one of the rarest cards you can get. Yep. Even now today, like if I still had it, that thing is worth, I don't even know. It was something like $1,000-something last I checked.
Yeah. Well, I've got stuff like when I look through my Pokemon card
collection. Anything, even
like
if it's not foil.
Anything first edition is super rare. And I've got like a first edition Vaporeon and stuff like that. Like, it feels, it sounds really selfish and it kind of is, but it feels good to have something that other people don't have because you're like, wow, this is, this doesn't just have, like, for me, I got them from a friend that moved away, so they're sentimental. But at the same time, they're also, like, there's that intrinsic value in it that's like, wow, this is a rare thing that not many people have. And I can take pride in that. And I guess that's one of the cool things, like, that's why the Amiibo were such a big hit, was because people were like, oh, well, I've got Dark Pit, and you can only get that at Best Buy for, like, 3 weeks. Or I've got this character, the golden Mario or whatever ones that are really rare, because it's like, well, this is something that not a lot of people have, and so that makes it that special item that I have. And again, like you said, it's always difficult because at one point you want to be like, oh, well, I understand why it's rare and why it's limited quality, but at the same time, like, it's ultimately up to Nintendo what they do with it. I hope they make more for my sake, because I don't have it and I want it.
Yeah, I just don't know. This is always a tough one for me, because what we're talking about is merchandise that adds no value to anything we experience with games. Like, it'd be different if it was hard to get a hold of the game. That is wrong. It's really cool that it would be really, like, how about that for a story? You can't pre-order Breath of the Wild anymore. It's sold out. That would be crazy to me. Not back in the day, back in the 90s when it was a lot harder and a lot more costly to overprint games, especially on cartridges back in the day, like when, you know, the famous landfill with all the E.T. games. Like, that happened because they printed way too much stuff. And again, you know, you could argue there's still a risk of that with Breath of the Wild being a cartridge-based game in Switch. But at the same time, they're going to make as many games as they could sell. So you're not going to have a hard time getting a hold of the game. So we're talking about merchandise, and maybe this is why I don't feel bad, because that's what we're talking about. This is merchandise that adds no value to our gameplay experience. It's just a collector's thing. It's just something you want.
If the Master's Edition came with extra story content that you could only get with the Master's Edition.
But it doesn't. It comes with items that it doesn't really matter if you have them or not.
Right.
You just want them because they're cool. And don't lie, part of you probably wants it out there, or part of the people watching this want it out there because it's sold out. And don't be kidding yourself. Like, oh, I always wanted it. Like, yeah, but there's some of you out there that you didn't really care, and then it got sold out, and you're like, damn, I wish I would have pre-ordered. Oh, the CD. Well, the only thing I want out of that is we live in the age of the internet, so like literally the day the game comes out, it's gonna be ripped and online somewhere.
That's true, but there's nothing like having that physical
copy. I know. Well, the first thing I'm doing is literally ripping it to my computer because I'm always going to keep the disc, but I can't guarantee that disc is not going to get scratched because it'll be playing in my car all the time.
Distribute that copy. Yo.
Distribute that copy.
Yo. At least to me.
I'll burn an extra copy.
Thanks. I love you, Nate.
In fact, wait. Okay. Yes, I do still have a way to burn CDs. I just had to think because my desktop does not have any player on it, but I have an old laptop that can still burn. So,
we're about an hour and a half mark, so I'm not going to hit that topic today.
Oh.
But there is some news that kind of came out
while we were doing
that
this.
I just wanted to touch really quickly. It was actually a day ago, but I didn't see it until just now. And this is only for European fans that are listening. But there's a game sale going on where it's 30% off of all Zelda games on the eShop. So you've got, for the Wii U, Hyrule Warriors, Legend of Zelda, Link to the Past, Majora's Mask, Phantom Hourglass, Ocarina of Time, Skyward Sword, Spirit Tracks, The Minish Cap, Twilight Princess HD, Wind Waker HD, and Zelda 2. Keep in mind that the 30% is only for My Nintendo members. And then 3DS, you have Hyrule Warriors Legends, Legend of Zelda, Link Between Worlds, Link to the Past, Link's Awakening DX, Majora's Mask 3D, Ocarina of Time 3D, Oracle of Ages, Seasons, Triforce Heroes, and Zelda 2. There's no word yet on whether or not this is coming to America. This is specifically a European thing. So feel free to jump on that if you want. But like Nate said, and like I said earlier, I'll be going to PAX this weekend. So I will be hopefully covering and playing the Switch and as much Breath of the Wild as I can, if that's an option. And then I'll be back to talk about my experience with that next week. I might see if I can get up a video. I'll have my small little...
Yeah, if you can record some gameplay, that'd be sweet. We could put it up as a Zelda Informer plays like I did from the E3.
I don't have anyone going with me, but I have some people I know that are going to be there, so I might have them record for me.
Yeah, that's one thing I regret about E3 is like now I have like this stand that I can put my phone in if I need to record footage, and I wish I would have had that back during E3. Would have made things so much easier.
I mean, I could bring it and set it up, but I'd rather just have somebody record for me. And so we'll see what I can get, and then I'll bring back and hopefully talk about.
Hey, see Zelda Informer play Breath of the Wild on Switch. Woo!
Yeah, who knows? Nintendo doesn't actually have a conference there or a panel. They specifically just have
come play the Switch every day.
I'll be there all weekend. I'm going to some other panels, but I'll be there all weekend.
You can play it on a fake airplane.
That's true. Hopefully.
Well, yeah, depends on how long the line is to get that airplane experience.
Yeah. Well, that's the main reason I'm going, so Massey's is going to be pretty upset if I don't actually get
any... Nah, zero footage.
For... I just went for
everything. I don't think Matthews will be that upset. It'd be different if he was paying.
No, I'm not getting. Yeah, I'm not getting paid for this.
Yeah, he won't be upset. We pretty much, in case the public knows, like most of our staff, like pretty much 99% of our staff is volunteer. And they always ask, like, I've been asked several times about, like, hey, can I use the other Deformer to get, like, a media pass for this thing? I'm like, yeah, you work here. Well, do you expect any coverage? I'm like, no. Do what you want. Like, you're paying your way to go. Like, you enjoy yourself. It's not like when I went to E3. Like, yeah, I went to E3 because it's my job. If you get footage, great. If you can't, oh well. I don't think Matthews isn't gonna care. I don't know if you saw the conversation about live streams. He doesn't really care about footage. But I would like to see footage because, like, the stuff that we got from E3, people on our YouTube channel really liked it. Like, that stuff's highly viewed stuff. Like 150,000 views or something. It's crazy.
I'll see what I can get. I'll probably get some videos of other people.
Try to beat Steph Talus on the Switch.
I'm just excited to play the Switch. I want to know what it feels like, what it's like, because that's not a... I'm surprised they're not actually doing what they do with Smash Brothers and putting it in different Best Buys.
Yeah, I'm a little surprised.
It's only at specific events.
Maybe the reason they're not doing that is because of the Joy-Cons. We're probably jacking those things.
Well, I think that and the fact that it's coming out in 2 months, like, if this was still, like, coming out in the summer, they'd be like, "Oh well, we need."
Oh, they're probably like, to play this, but we are already sold out. We don't have the extra stock to put up demo stations right now."
Yeah. But yeah, that's where I'll be this weekend. I'll be living it up alone in a hotel room somewhere.
One last interesting note to bring up.
Myself to sleep.
I don't know how many people care, but the Pro Controller only got approved in the United States by the FCC like 4 days ago. Which is why the Pro Controller was not available to pre-order till today, and it went up for pre-order without any warning, no emails about it, no nothing. So obviously it's completely sold out, and sold out within seconds. The Pro Controller isn't like a limited edition thing, so it kind of feels like it's something that kind of got mishandled by Nintendo of America, in my opinion. Like, even if it's not their fault it took this long to get approved, like, they submitted it at the same time as the Switch itself, and for some reason the FCC drug their feet on it. It is Nintendo's fault for allowing this stuff to go up for pre-order without any warning whatsoever. This isn't like the Switch event on the 12th that you knew at midnight is probably going to be for pre-order online. Like, you can just assume this is like the big announcement event. It's going to be up for pre-order. Anyways, I don't know. I'm just a little flummoxed that Nintendo allowed that to happen with probably the peripheral that people who are buying the Switch are most interested in.
And speaking of random news that came up without anybody actually knowing it, Pokemon Company released an app called Pokemon Duel, which is kind of it's really hard to explain.
Go watch some footage. Game Explain put up a 20-minute segment of them playing it.
It's extremely
broken. It looks like an awesome idea.
It is. Well, I'm talking about it's so buggy. It's every 10 seconds it tries to connect to the internet, tries to load. So it's really hard. It freezes all the time. So they've got a lot of work to do before it's gameplay ready. But interesting concept, interesting idea. They didn't say anything
they just
about
released
it to anyone.
And said, here's a trailer. Considering the success of Pokemon Go, would you at least want to announce that you're making this game? No, we're just going to throw it out there. And maybe this speaks to, granted, this is the Pokemon company, and Nintendo doesn't necessarily get to say how they handle this stuff. But I wonder if this is part of even a little talk with Nintendo, because Nintendo talked about how with mobile games they want to try different strategies. They try something with Miitomo, that is what it is, it's not a game, so how much you could judge from that, I don't know. But then, Super Mario Run, they did the, it's $10 for the whole game, and we're going to let you play it for a little bit, and then, hit you with that paywall, and people really didn't like how the paywall was approached in the game, because it was a little abrupt. There was no gradual, it didn't feel like you played enough of the game to be hit with a paywall, basically. So they did that with that game. Pokemon Go obviously had a totally different strategy. It's all microtransaction based free to play. Pokemon Go worked like a lot of other games work. And now here's a Pokemon game. We're like, well, instead of us announcing and putting a marketing campaign behind it, let's just release this thing that might not even be fully finished yet and just see what happens. And I wonder if that's just like another Nintendo, hey, just throw it out there, because we want to see all these different marketing strategies work on mobile. And this is like a zero marketing strategy. But because it's Pokemon, it's
probably
going to blow up.
We didn't even know this game was in development.
Which is probably why they're having all these issues. Because it's way more popular than they probably thought it was going to be. Because for some reason, Nintendo doesn't think anything's popular. Pokemon doesn't think anything's popular.
Yeah.
I can understand why they didn't think Pokemon Go was going to be as big. Who could have predicted that? You could predict it was going to be popular, but like the best app of all time. You can't predict that. So you can almost forgive some of the server hiccups with that at launch, but this is one that's really? I don't know. The thing is, it looks really cool. I haven't tried it yet. I haven't downloaded. It looks really cool.
The two matches I've
played. It looks like, because Game Explain actually got a nice segment where they got to play it for a little bit before it started bugging out. I'm like, this actually looks really cool. This looks like stuff that I feel like I should have known about.
But that's up for you guys to check out. If it works for you. It released simultaneously on both the Android store and the App Store.
Yay.
So it's out now.
Fat.
as you're watching this, listening to it. And yeah, that's pretty much all we got for this week. Hopefully I'll have more next week to lay some stuff on you guys. This was actually one of our heaviest Zelda news featured weeks in a very long time, because it's been Switch.
What happens when you get blasted?
Yeah, Pokemon Duel. This one is literally listed by the Pokemon Company, so it this is not like a Niantic made game or Nintendo. Like the Pokemon Company themselves are the ones behind it. No, and not Game Freak, by the way. The Pokemon Company. But yeah, this is gonna be interesting.
Alright, well,
I'm trying to launch it right now and it won't even load, so
yeah, see you guys. We'll see you guys next week.